I'll just leave it as it is.
Singing.
Can you hear me if I speak over it? Okay, so
yes.
We can turn it down if anyone has a problem. But this is a piece we composed in collaboration with a Blueprint Choir in Portland, Oregon, based on a commission that we got to do a show in Kunsthalle Aarhus in Denmark. And it's called Loser. And we gave the choir instructions of how to sing this improvised instead of a strictly musical score. We asked them to improvise with the refrain of Beck's hit song Loser.
And the idea, which I guess maybe is a little obvious, that
it's frozen.
Oh yeah.
Sorry. So
the idea is the symbolic idea of the choir as voices coming together and as bodies coming together in the same space, sharing a physical space and sharing their voice, and to have this idea of collaboration and non-individualistic behavior in the context of a competition, so competition versus collaboration.
Yeah, the choir represents a collective public, and this is what we're interested in thinking about in general. And it also represents this word loser. In the case of Beck, is completely the opposite. I mean, Beck is a winner and literally a Scientologist, and has this kind of like connections with capitalism. Like, there are only losers because there are winners in capitalism. And this theme will kind of come through a lot of the work. We started with this piece because we wanted to acknowledge that although we were trained in visual art and art history and film, we started actually making sound and sound art and music in 1998. And so we started working together as an artist duo making sound art. And so we were 12 years working almost exclusively with sound. And we don't have time to play 12 years of sound that we made, but just to suggest that this is a background in this piece. And a lot of sound comes often back into our work, like with this piece.
This is from 2019, so we still keep making sound, but it's not our primary mode of working anymore.
Yes. Okay, so what we decided to do was, we not only do we not have time to play 10 years of audio works for you, we also don't have time to play 15 years of exhibition history. So we're going to present a number of install shots And we won't describe the projects because there are too many, but we thought it would be nice that you could just see the general things that we're working with. So it's about 12 years of install shots in institutions. And then we will stop and get into a couple of pieces. And then we'll spend a lot of time on the latest two works. So this is a billboard that we did of close-ups of money in Birmingham, UK, Eastside Projects, a carpet piece that we did throughout the Van Abbey Museum in Eindhoven. This is a show about economics where there's a video projected and works put on the wall in the former customs house in Graz, Austria. An exhibition in 047 in Oslo.
Which is an architectural gallery, artist architect.
So one thing that so we don't have time to get into the pieces, but we would say that in these shows, in this one and several other shows that we're showing you, we were doing feng shui readings of the space, and we were installing works based on shape and color that was following feng shui recommendations for how to improve the feng shui of a space.
So we will invite a feng shui master to come and give us a consultation and then tell us what works we should install where and in what shape and colors and that kind of.
So with this one, for example, there was some need to move the eye through the space and then to move the chi, and then there's a need for red on this side. And so we were actually making an exhibition come alive based on the feng shui reading. This is at Jaspis in Stockholm. And again, the pieces are installed visually based on a composition that we thought was pleasing, but also based on feng shui recommendations. And this one as well. This is a Grünerløkka Kunsthalle in Oslo. It's a Dumbo Art Center in New York. The feng shui expert that we worked with here, a remarkable person, also worked with Donald Trump in Trump Industries, did the feng shui readings in Trump hotels, among others, and has worked with other like large New York notables. Very powerful, very, very interesting woman. Who immediately got why we were doing it. One of the problems, for example, in this space is that it's bad feng shui to work under a bridge. So bridges are bad feng shui because they move the waters in certain ways. We were thinking about New York as like bad feng shui in general because of the configuration of waters. But what she said is that because the whole neighborhood is under the bridge, the whole neighborhood is technically bad feng shui. And so therefore it's not possible to fix the whole neighborhood, but you can do like one place at a time. And she recommended that we paint the column gold here. And so as we worked our way through feng shui, and we haven't been doing feng shui readings as closely, I mean, because we're not feng shui experts, we were actually working with feng shui experts to advise us on how to produce the exhibitions according to feng shui principles. But what we did was that kind of morphed its way into a different reading of space that's based on other things. So we are kind of, we were picking up on the sensibilities of feng shui and reading spaces with that sensibility, but not using those precise principles.
And not making an explicit point in the work itself anymore. This is a space in Porto, Portugal, which is our favorite space, hands down. The building is 300 years old and it has never been renovated. And when an artist does a show, they paint if something needs to be painted, and then that's it. That's all that is done to the space. So when we were working in this specific room, there was black mold in there. So we cleaned it with bleach. And then the curator was kind of horrified that we're removing the mold, but we're like, we can't handle the mold. But otherwise it just has these beautiful layers of history of before it was an art space and all the changes that the neighborhood has gone through.
Yeah, I guess the thing about this space, it's a dirty space. It's not a proper place for showing art. There's clear like community concerns. It damages the work. A work that we had in there, which we'll show you later, was actually stolen from the place. It is a kind of complicated scene to show artwork. And yet the audience is so fantastic. And the people that see the works understand this about the space. And so you work with a space like this because it is so particular, and because the people involved are so wonderful, and because the audience is so wonderful, and because the feeling there is so wonderful, despite it being complicated and like very, very decidedly not museum-like.
This is a collaboration that we did with Piscine, which is a Danish artist collective. And we made these banners, which were installed in different spaces, indoors and outdoors. And also we made the clothing line, which is this one. And also we made the video that we don't have time to show it to you, but it is online if you want to look at it, which is that one.
We collaborated again with Piscine to produce this work, also at Kunsthalle Aarhus in Denmark. Okay, so now we're going to slow down a little bit and talk about the work on the right particularly. So this is a shot of our solo at the Luminary in 2016. And we want to talk about the piece that's on the right, the Google wall. So for those of you who have seen these, the Google Doodles, it's a kind of on the homepage, they changed the Google Doodle that to commemorate different things. This is a celebration of the 176th birthday of Mark Twain. It shows this classic scene from The Adventures of Tom Sawyer where Tom gets someone else to paint Aunt Polly's white picket fence. And then this is what we made from it. Should I read it or do you want to read it?
Well, I can read it. So we will just read the segment from the Tom Sawyer book. What do you call work? Why, ain't that work? Tom resumed his whitewashing and answered carelessly. Well, maybe it is and maybe it ain't. All I know is it suits Tom Sawyer. Oh, come now. You don't mean to let on that you like it? The brass continued to move. Like it? Well, I don't see why I oughtn't to like it. Does a boy get the chance to whitewash a fence every day? That put the thing on a new light. Ben stopped nibbling his apple. Tom swept his brass daintily back and forth, stepped back to note the effect, added a touch here and there, criticized the effect again. Then Ben watching every move and getting more and more interested, more and more absorbed. Presently, he said, Tom, let me whitewash a little.
So it's this classic scene where work, what is clearly labor, is reframed as being something that's fun or maybe even creative. And so Tom then, by pretending that this work is fun and creative, actually manipulates his friend to do the work for him. This is like a classic and incredible metaphor for web 2.0, for social media, for social media users who are in fact laborers in an economic framework. So this is a very striking metaphor for us. So what we wanted to do was call attention to that and how we decided to do it was to partially draw this mural of the Google doodle on the wall, and then to put markers on the floor. You can see there's a series of markers on the floor, and then these markers, we encourage the public to write whatever they wanted on it, which is a tradition in Facebook and other tech companies to do a signature wall. And so in effect, we were having people do our piece for us, which is a kind of perverse flip. But we also were there and talking with people in, about this situation and having conversations about people about the sort of free labor that everyone's putting into social media.
There was also a commentary a little bit on social practice and the use of humans as material for artworks that we also find dubious. But as Aeron was saying, we were there and we could talk about it with the people who were participating.
And the thing to note is that now in like late stage capitalism or late stage neoliberal economies, it's framed that we're all creatives. And this word creatives is really used a lot. And the creative work that we are meant to be doing is this kind of endless free labor that we're putting into social media sites. And on the one hand, it is just a simple means of communication. You know, one person asked us, what's the difference between social media, Facebook, and a telephone? And, you know, while they share similar things, I mean, the internet is like the telephone more than Facebook. Facebook has a very, very particular economic model. And the economic model is to convince people to spend as much time as possible and to share as much or overshare as much as possible in order to refine the tastes and sensibilities of the most like incredibly complete surveillance system for capitalism like ever invented. So they're selling this data, as we all know, so I don't need to restate this, but Facebook and other companies are selling our personal data in highly refined target groups kind of situations to sell adverts. And so while this seems innocuous, it's also, we have to understand that we are laboring for free at the core to enable this system to happen.
But it's not only Facebook, it's how the internet is set up that, you know, if you remember in the 90s, the internet was this kind of chunky and unmonetizable kind of potential, and it has become every human gesture on the internet is monetized, if possible.
Yeah.
So this is the last show that we did before lockdown. It was February 2020, and it is in Phoenix, Arizona. The space is called Sand. And it was a very beautiful situation because it shows what can happen with art. The two people who ran the space, they met because they were helping us run our space in Seattle. And that's how they met and they became a couple. And then when they were running their own space, they invited us to show with them. And of course, they didn't have any money to do this. They just got, they were lent this office space, office industrial space, while it was being sold. So it was on the market, but in the meantime, they could use it for exhibitions. And it was this kind of do-it-yourself, and everyone was really contributing what they could. And the space was really incredible. Yes. So it was kind of good that it was our last show because it was a really good one.
So the space, we should mention it because what we decided to do was rather than just place artworks in a space as though it were an art museum or a gallery, we decided to make the space a site-specific space. The space is very peculiar in that it is literally in an office industrial zone of Phoenix, like just next to like a marijuana facility, and just next to like a facility that makes dildos.
And a private airport.
And a private airport.
It's really strange.
So it's Dunkin' Donuts. So it's like right next to this like very particular like area of capitalism that are in big cities, where this was a currently empty office space. So literally an office space. And we used the furniture from the previous tenants of this place. So we decided to make the whole thing site specific. So you enter the space, and then what you see is our, it looks like it could just be an office space with some posters in the back, and there's a text on the table. And then as you move through the space, so this is upstairs in the boardroom. So we just repurposed. I mean, this is literally the table and chairs from the previous board of the whatever corporation was in this building before. We didn't move anything at all. We just left everything as it was. And we projected this video on the wall of public domain video footage from the US Forest Service of birds. And so like the, it, but it is site specific. It's not just about the video at this point. It's really the video in this very particular site. So everyone that sat down in this boardroom could see the video, but also very clearly were sitting in a boardroom. What was like obviously and very like directly a repurposed boardroom. We didn't construct any of this. This is how it was.
That was really beautiful because as you can see, it was almost getting evening and the light was gold. And then you could see the Phoenix landscape through the window. It was really magical.
And this is one of the rooms. And so we made these posters. We've been working on these posters using Raymond Williams keywords. So for those of you who don't know Raymond Williams, you should have a look. So Raymond Williams was a Welsh sociologist who researched the keywords of capitalism and tracing how their definition changed through the years, words like trade, welfare, risk, vision. And so, and then this work has been updated to include neoliberal keywords. So academics are exploring how the use of words in capitalism is very particular and very peculiar.
And how it's being shifted, how words of meaning of words have changed.
Right. So like a word like creativity has a kind of particular meaning, we think, but actually it's used in very special ways in capitalism, as I just mentioned, like we are the creatives, you know, we are all entrepreneurs, even though we're actually citizens, you know, in a community, but like that part of our existence in the United States is underplayed compared to how we are creative capitalists and creative entrepreneurs within the system. So we're no longer citizens at per se, we're actually, you know, we're competitors with each other. So anyway, so we made these graphic design posters so that it looked like corporate language in a way, like they could be corporate logos, they could be posters for a company, but that we're using these terms that are very, very loaded.
Maybe if the goal was to make them a bit like logos, but also a little bit cheesy. You know how logos can be, like if the word is liquid, you have a logo that is meant to look like water. So it's meant to be kind of like using modernist design and Bauhaus typography, but also to be kind of cheesy on purpose, or corporate cheesy on purpose.
And so then the other site that's really was spectacular in this location where we showed is that this is literally a warehouse that was emptied out. It used to have, I think it was car parts in this warehouse, shelves of car parts. So we emptied out, it was mostly empty, but we completely cleaned it out from this section.
And
we,
the back room.
In the back room. So this is the same building, it's just the back room of, so there's upstairs is a boardroom, downstairs is a reception and office, and then in the back there's this this boardroom. I mean, this warehouse space.
When you came in, you listened to this sound?
So the room was mostly empty except for two very striking things. First of all, is the sound of birds. And second, you see at these cans of Everglade forest scent, we actually sprayed the scent every half an hour or so. So all the visitors to the show could smell the scent of the forest and could hear the forest birds, but in this dark back room, this kind of ominous storage room.
And this is a public domain recording tool done by the Department of Wildlife, US Department.
So people would look around for birds, and there's a sense that there could be birds in there, but it's just an audio recording. It's kind of unnerving to smell a forest and hear the forest sounds and be in this other space. And of course, the smell is not quite right because it's glade. It's not exactly a nice forest smell. And this is the only other piece in that huge warehouse. So it was empty except for the smell, the sound, and then this this stack.
Which is a stack of objects that we have around our house. Some things are for Agnes, from Agnes, our daughter. That's her baby blanket. The painting is a gift that the friend gave us. Different things that we, materials that we had around our house. And then on the top of it is the US budget for the year. That was America first. This was 2020.
So we literally just wrote the US government printing office to ask for the budget. So this is the actual budget of the US government from 2019. And so that's the end of that show. We would just say that, you know, it's like dealing with these sites, it's interesting because art has this potential of being a portable object where it can sort of exist in any site. But if you kind of turn that around, then site specificity becomes very interesting. That the location of this place was a literal frame. And when we look at the floor, we didn't touch this floor. The floor is stained and like scuffed and beat up from the actual activity of this warehouse of the tenants that were there before. And it's like part of the piece now. So you start to look at these things and think about how the artworks can resonate with that. So this is a stack, and we've been doing stacks now for a little while. And basically how we think of a stack is collections of objects around our house, in some cases drawings that we do that we don't use other places, Agnes's drawings, various scraps of paper, broken cups, the detritus and things that are kind of interesting in our life. And we bring them together, particularly very often with books, the books that we're reading or thinking about, or books that are making us upset. Books that are problematic, books that are influential. And I think it's this combination of our daily life, of these objects that seem to have a connection with us, but not quite readable, along with these books that for us, it's a kind of fascinating thing. So we continued with the stacks in, during the pandemic, and this is about.
Right, so now we're in the pandemic, in the chronology, we're in the pandemic. So we decided to re-photograph all archive of our work during the pandemic. We had it in a storage in the basement, and then we made different assemblage of our past work together with objects that we had around our house of our daily life, together with books that influenced the work, and we photographed them inside the house, outside the house, when we were taking walks with Agnes, as a way to remove these works from the institution, because the only documentation that we had from these works was what we just showed you, institutional shots. And then we were thinking that these objects lived beyond the exhibition space, beyond the institution. And how could they then coexist with one another and coexist with the influences that made them and the influences that will make future works and our life in general.
So as she just said, we're thinking about the porousness of the production. And this is the piece, by the way, that we showed a version of it in Porto and it got stolen. So we just find this like a beautiful conclusion to this, because as we know, Ayn Rand, the virtue of selfishness, and our piece was that we mailed this book to ourselves using Ayn Rand stamps. So it was a kind of funny, perverse pun that we mailed this book to ourselves, but it's very perfect that it got stolen. So we just like to point this out, that someone liked it so much, or maybe someone recognized the irony of it and selfishly stole it. But we made a couple of versions, so we had that in our house. But we're thinking about the porousness of production, that many of the things that we have in our house, are, you know, in our environment, they were thinking about the things that make us. And those things are also, they're informing us as individuals, and they're informing us as artists. And these everyday objects and symbols and frames, I think it's entangled with creativity. So this word creativity is, you know, as we've been problematizing it, as you can hear, but we can say that sometimes to be uncreative is somehow more important, to sort of remove our feeling of expression out of the situation and have that sort of like the refusal to be creative, to be part of something of like a production of something else. And so again, you can see that Ayn Rand is showing up a lot. This book is extremely disturbing to us. And so we keep coming back to it. And we sometimes read it just to get angry.
It's angry, but also to see how an argument can be formed. Because when you read the book, you are almost convinced by the argument. And you know, this is what happens in every system of oppression, that you have to rationalize it, you have to back it up with argument, and you have to make it seem ethical, because no one wants to do something that is evil. So you have to convince people that they are not participating in something that is evil. So it serves as an example for a lot of systems of oppression.
So what we have here is a photograph, almost like an advertisement for a book, like we could sell this book. But for us, it's this striking thing in which the road to serfdom, for example, of Hayek's economic text, which we can talk about more later. But for now, we'll just say that it is a highly influential economic text that rationalizes certain neoliberal policy. And the way that they are rationalized are very clever and very convincing. So when you read this book, if you didn't have a bigger picture in mind, the arguments are very convincing. The end result is austerity and a total lack of social cohesion and extreme capitalism, where, you know, where forest fires are somehow a problem that the individual has to deal with, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And the same with Ayn Rand. And so like to put these books in natural settings, makes it kind of clear that arguments are framed as though they were natural. And this for us is a very striking point. So certain ideological arguments in particular neoliberal arguments about competition and about the meritocracy and about who is a winner and a loser in a system, they're framed as though they were natural. And yet the natural quality that they have has to be construction based on politics. And so they're not natural at all. They are put into, these policies are put into play because of the political system, because of certain ideological individuals. So they're not natural.
Because the argument is that in nature is the survival of the fittest, and you eat or you get eaten. But part of our research is finding instances in nature when that's not true, when collaboration happens. So to deny the naturalness of competition, but also of harming other humans.
And this is a series of photos along the same lines as the stacks. And we wrote an essay about Detroit, and it was published in a journal in Finland, and this is the book. And so we just opened the book, and these are the illustrations of photographs that we took in Detroit on the left. But we paired it with drawings and cutouts that Agnes made on the right. And then on this paper, this colorful paper, which is like a side paper that when one does watercolors, you do these splotches. And so it's like not really a painting, but it looks like a painting. Paired with the drop cloth behind, it looks like stars, but they're not stars. It's actually a painting drop cloth. So we paired these layers of things of meaning there. And I'll just read this statement that we, because we also write a lot. And so sometimes it's the writing will just, I'll just read it. Material and speculative realities walk hand in hand, listening for unknown frequencies, wondering what happened to the leisure we thought would eventually arrive, but instead has been replaced with a realistic political economy that magically favors capital over life. Pondering our practice, we revel in the generative possible rearrangements of substance and environment. So although they're kind of documentations in a way of our previous works and our previous efforts and also our life, they also become a new, they're a new object, they're a new thing. And they could exist sculpturally, as in the case in sand in Phoenix, and they could exist in photos, and we're kind of working on what the next step will be.
The nice thing about these two is that they can always continue. We can always build these assemblages, and we can do them in our home, which was part of our pandemic project, to have a practice that could be both produced, documented, and in a way exhibited at home.
Yeah.
So, another project that we started it before the pandemic, but we focused it a lot over the past year. We focused on it a lot over the past year.
So this one we're going to get even more in depth in, and to describe the processes and to describe how we got there.
So we painted new paintings with the Goya prints, The Disasters of War. We titled our work also The Disasters of War. We painted with the 83 prints. Goya's depiction of suffering is a very embodied, is very much about tortured bodies that are suffering. It's very unromantic, non-heroic depictions of the horrors of war. And we painted with the Goya, this is our studio here at home, we painted with the Goya to do a few things. One, to conceal the specificity of the war that Goya was depicting, and then make it not about this specific war, but human-made disasters, such as environmental destruction and climate change.
So by concealing human bodies, so these are, again, we painted right on the etchings, and this, the book that we chose is a 100-year-old book that it's like a really fine reproductions of the Goyas, and also reproduced in the original size. The Goya's prints, we don't have the money to buy Goya's prints and deface them, but this is a reproduction of Goya's prints that, I mean, it still was $120 or something to buy the book, so it was a commitment to sort of deface this book.
But arguably, I think it's something nice about having such a multiple, working with such a multiple, but that this is still true to the original.
Right. So we painted on top, and we painted in order to conceal the human bodies. So in each one, our first target was to try and figure out how to make a painting, a composition with Goya's composition, that Goya centered the human bodies and centered the suffering and dismemberment and torture of human bodies. And we tried to recenter that, instead to think about it in terms of to decenter the human perspective and decenter the sort of psychological aspects of the human, and instead put landscape and earth as the center. And we were thinking about this in terms, particularly because of the forest fires last year. And so as like the West Coast was burning and it's starting up again.
But we did a lot of this when we couldn't leave the house during the Oregon fires. And then we started thinking and reading a lot about how ink is made, because these are made using ink. About how the ink itself is a byproduct of soot, and specifically burning any vegetation, but mostly pine branches, and then mixing it with some kind of agent such as a wheat paste.
So black ink is made from obtaining carbon from soot, such as lamp black, particularly by burning trees, sap, sometimes bones, tar pitch, and other substances. But it is particularly common to get soot for ink from burning tree sap. A surface covered with lamp black or a dense black ink will absorb about 97% of incident light, making it strong, dark, and durable. So here's the thing. We were thinking about like ink in terms of this this substance made from burning. And like as we could smell the forest fires burning, and we were thinking about the horrors of climate change and the horrors of you know, being worried about the fires and the smoke inhalation. And at the same time, humans from very, very long time ago, so it wasn't just one culture that discovered that using carbon could make a very high quality ink. It was many cultures, almost completely universal. Almost all cultures independently discovered using carbon makes high quality ink. And many cultures also furthermore refined it to use pine sap, or to use the sap of a tree that's similar, has similar characteristics. And here's the funny thing. In the 1980s, a new molecule of graphite was discovered called fullerenes. So there's like the way that the graphite molecule binds itself, the scientists didn't notice that there was this form that was round, and they called it fullerenes, and it was incredible overlooked carbon molecule. So like most major discoveries in science happened a long time ago. So that this was just discovered in the 1980s is somewhat incredible. This graphite molecule called fullerenes is hollow. It looks like a soccer ball, and it was named after Buckminster Fuller, because Buckminster Fuller made an architectural discovery that triangles placed together in a certain way makes a very, very strong structure, and they're called buckyballs. Or I don't know if you've seen like the Walt Disney Epcot Center dome. So that's a buckyball.
And he was thinking about it being very resistant and durable, but also being very cheap and easy to build. And he was like kind of this utopian project that everyone would be housed through this system of triangles.
So this molecule, this graphite molecule, very stable and strong. It actually has medical and environmental applications. So they're trying to figure out how it can be, it's hollow. And so medicine can be injected into them, and then it can be administered. And they also have industrial uses in that they make a really good lubricant. And it's discovered that pine sap soot, the exact same stuff that the Korean tradition and the Japanese tradition and some other traditions used as the highest quality ink, the highest quality lamp black ink, has a high percentage of fullerenes. So the fullerenes make the ink stable. It makes it better. It makes it more, smoother, more durable and lasting. So this carbon molecule that scientists just discovered in the 80s, traditional knowledge, traditional craftspeople from at least China and Japan and Korea understood this a very long time ago. So it's interesting that scientific knowledge can like come out in different ways, and like pre-science, it's powerful that people could know something without knowing why.
Right, and that's what is very attractive to us, how much humans know without exactly knowing, this kind of like intuitive knowing.
In ancient Egypt, ink was also used by burning wood or oil and the mixing resulting concoction with water. Ancient Maya, carbon black was used with our carbon black ink made of soot was scraped off the bottom of cooking pans was used of a high sustaining quality. And notably, the Aztec word for ink, referring to soot and the verb to produce smoke. So Tulapapazali connects smoke and soot, linking ink to fire. So this connection with fire is actually very old and symbolic. It's based on its origin and also the dark color symbolically linking ink to the night sky, but also the word to produce smoke, it's the assumption of burning, which of course stars are the fires that burn in the darkness. So we love that they have all these like fantastic symbolic qualities within the substance itself. So the ink being a very like symbolic substance. Hebrew, dio, it means ink or fluid for writing. So the Ladino is the Hebrew and Spanish together. So the cognate is dio, and the cognate then links Ladino with Spanish. So dio or dios, God. The Torah, traditionally hand-scribed, written in ink, a physical link to the holy immaterial. Kosher ink came from burning vegetable fat, especially olive oil. In Torah scrolls and widely, an extra binding element added in the 8th century from adding oak gallnut powder, which reacted with the paper, creating permanence. So it's very powerful and interesting to think of ink as this substance that people from a very long time ago, from a fairly wide range, understood the power of it. And that not only do they understand that this could be used in this symbolic way, but they also, there's like the slow enhancement of it. So like they, for example, like adding oak gallnut powder actually improved the permanence of ink. And all this done in a kind of sustainable way. But we have to understand that ink is instrumental. It's a very instrumental basic substance, which is instrumental in the development of literacy, law, democracy, culture, diplomacy, and world trade. So this simple stuff, independently developed by hundreds of cultures worldwide, is actually essential for human culture. The business expression in the black refers to positive earnings, meaning earnings recorded into the books in black ink rather than the losses recorded in red ink. So even now we have this powerful symbolic understanding of ink being essential in culture.
And then back to our Goya drawings. We aim to transform the historical specificity of Goya's disasters to a generalized environmental dread, horror and disasters, contra el bien general, against the general good, that we are all experiencing together now, some more acutely than others.
So according to Timothy Morton, who's writing about kind of like teleology and thinking about the Anthropocene is like the effects of humans actually being so great on the earth that there's now a new epoch, an epoch named after us, the Anthropocene. So Timothy Morton wrote about the deepest anxiety is the devastation of our ecosystem. And he advocates to replace the term global warming with a stronger term, mass extinction, which is the net effect. So while extreme weather and geological events caused by the net effects of capitalism are very much real, it's also kind of unthinkable. So every time we have these massive forest fires, it's unimaginable. We somehow just can't believe it. And especially for those of us who haven't been directly in the middle of a forest fire, it seems like unthinkable. It's hard to process. It's off the wall. And the same thing with climate change, like these temperatures are, we're going to get a heat wave of 110, and like 110 degrees is the highest that Portland has ever seen, apparently. Amitav Ghosh, an Indian writer, wrote that writing about extreme environmental events risks banishment from serious literature. It's like so difficult to comprehend that like it seems unrealistic to talk about. And therefore, many of the most powerful voices dealing with climate change and like this extreme horror actually of our earth burning are from lesser forms of literature, fantasy horror and science fiction. So this struck a chord with us because it's indicating that widespread denial of climate change and extinction events is normalized. But how do we envision the planet-wide catastrophe of climate change without relying on sensationalism. I mean, it seems sensationalist to say that we're dealing with mass extinction, and yet that's exactly what's going on. So it's hard to like be serious and not seem hyperbolic when the situation is so really hyperbolic that it seems absurd to even mention that. So we're thinking about Goya again, Los Desastres de Guerra. These drawings are notable because they're unromantic and they are not heroic. And we're wondering how climate change and mass extinction could be represented by the brutal effects of its concrete effects. But the process involving geological time is these movements are on a scale that we can't comprehend as humans. So basically, this is an inexpressible, unfathomable enormity of horror. And we're trying to figure this out. One thing that I could say is the process of making these drawings, of meditating with the substance, you know, painting with ink, getting ink on our hands, of sitting there hour after hour, listening to music and painting and meditating on these subjects, using this substance that's been around for thousands of years, it just struck us that this could be part of the solution.
Maybe we will talk a little bit about this project.
Let's take a break. And I think what could be done now is if you go to thevirtuesofselfishness.com.
Oh, that's a good idea, because this is a website that we also did during quarantine.
So if you follow the link, we made a series of websites, and this one is talking about some of the similar issues. So let's take a few minutes break, and then we will talk about this project and then move on to the last project we want to talk about.
There is a PDF that you can download in the website.
Thank you for sharing. That was fantastic.
Okay, so we'll come back in 5 minutes and we'll continue a little bit longer.
No, put it back. No, we should give a second for everyone to come back.
Everyone back? Okay.
So this is the project that we were telling you about, where we were researching different forms of collaboration in nature. And then we looked for public domain images of the documentation of this collaboration in nature. And then therefore seeing forms of collaboration both in culture and in nature.
Yeah, so as we mentioned several times, there's a lot of things that are sold in neoliberal capitalism that seem like they are facts of nature, that they are just normal. So competition is a very strong one. It's assumed that we must be in competition with each other. It's assumed that competition is just simply the laws of nature, and therefore we must get on board with that project. And so what we found is an enormous amount of examples in nature where collaboration is instead the norm. And we're compiling this archive as we go. But what we wanted to do was we wanted to show an example of collaboration in culture, and that is the public domain. So public domain images are where people share their images for free use. And so all the images that we found here are either from the US government or for universities or individuals that decide to make their photographs in the public domain. And so
we were talking about basically the commons, the strength of the commons, and that which is for the benefit of everyone, which could be scientific research and developments, which could be vaccines or public lands different structures of the public benefit and development.
So we could say that that there's been a debunking of the commons as a valuable place for civilization. And among others, there's this very cited book called The Tragedy of the Commons. And the assumptions in The Tragedy of the Commons are, it's a kind of fiction, it's a fictional account of the failure of a commons system. And it's not actually researched in any known moment of history. So the account is as follows, and you might sound familiar. So The Tragedy of the Commons states, this book states that in any commons of common grazing land, all the individuals involved will increase their cattle to a point that the land can't support the number of cattle anymore. And so they're saying that because all actors in a commons are selfish, they're trying to get the commons, they're trying to get as much out of the commons as they can, as selfish actors, as a normal way of behaving, that it will eventually destroy the commons. So that tragedy means that
the commons talking about landscape only.
In this case, landscape, but it's a symbol for all forms of commons. And so like it's this rationale is used for privatization, the understanding that privatization is the rational way of managing resources, because private interest will always be selfish and private interest will always have to be in negotiation with other private interests. So that is sold to us as a fact of nature. And yet Eleanor Ostrom and many others, but particularly Eleanor Ostrom who did fantastic work on the commons, she actually won a Nobel Prize in economics.
She was the first woman, right?
The first woman. And I mean, the Nobel Prize in Economics is a problem because it's not actually given by the Nobel Committee. It's given by the economics department of, but anyway, so long story short, Eleanor Ostrom actually won a prize it's a very conservative economics prize, but the data that she presented was so overwhelming. She basically studied examples of commons all over the world. So she went to Basque fishing grounds, she went to various like goat herders in Switzerland. She studied individuals in Indonesia doing like sharing fishing waters. And she studied actual like real life examples of how the commons are managed. And what she found is in example after example after example, the normal way is commons is managed in a very efficient system of cooperation. And so the people who share these grazing lands or fishing lands on a smaller scale. Now we're not talking France and England competing with each other for fishing grounds. We're talking about smaller scale commons only function because everyone involved in it understands how to efficiently share the resources. And they also understand, and they have actually put in rules, in some cases explicit rules, and in many cases inherent rules or implied rules to that allows certain people to function in the commons in certain ways and discourages certain selfish behaviors. So, and she has this in like books and books and books of data where she actually went to these places and she studied these cultures rationally managing commons situations. And this was so mind-blowing for like neoliberal economists who assume that human nature would have to be selfish in nature, would have to like that all humans behave like irrationally selfishly.
But of course, when you're talking about your livelihood, you know that you don't want to run out of the resource, that you don't want to deplete that which not only you, but your family survives from. So she made very compelling arguments of why people would not act selflessly in sharing land
right.
in this way.
And so for us, this kind of selling of natural facts that are in fact unnatural is a very, it's a powerful thing that we're trying to deal with and cope with and make works about. And so and one way we found is to make works about the exact opposite truth. And so while Eleanor Astrom is able to go and study these cultures and write books about them, we are making artworks that discuss these issues in a kind of quicker way. So we made this website called The Virtues of Selfishness. And of course, it's Nan Rand's book. And it's like a pointed finger at the kind of mentality that could form that assumption. And then we find these very clear examples like grizzly bears and berry plants that help each other, ants and fungi help each other, mycorrhizal fungi and plants, oxpecker and bison. There's so many examples in nature.
And like one beautiful story was the pando trees, which share the same roots. Of course, all the trees kind of communicate through roots, but these actually have the same roots. And this photo was taken by a ranger, a forest park ranger. And then because he works for the US government, his photos are public domain because this is a rule under copyright law that every work by the a government employee is in the public domain. So we called him up and
called him on the phone. We found his phone number.
We were like, Ranger, do you have photos of these trees? And he was like, yeah, let me send them to you. How you want them high quality? So in getting these photos, I mean, some of them we just downloaded them from the internet, but in some of them, it was kind of nice to see what kind of processes happen to create a public domain of images.
And so for us, you know, this experience of calling this ranger on the phone and describing our project to him, and he liked it immediately and liked us and sent us a high quality photo within like 20 minutes. And this is a beautiful thing. This is collaboration, and it's collaboration with like, you know, we credit all of his photos in this way, but it's like this wonderful thing that as artists, it's not just about producing the image, it also can be about like dealing with images and managing images and like shifting images and placing images together. And in some cases, working with the people who have made the images. And like our job as artists is to sort of re-highlight the potential of these images. And in the case of the ranger, he was just taking some photos of his workplace. He works in this national park. And then he thought it was cool that we would make a website with them and we would discuss it under these terms. and liked the idea that he would be included in the project. And so for us, it's this really nice thing where as artists, we have this power. You know, many thousands of people have gone to these websites, and although we can't say we're as popular as some of the viral hits or whatever, but like many thousands of people have looked at this and have thought about this topic. And that for us is a kind of success, even though it might not be like massively successful, like we haven't been written about in the New York Times or whatever, but still, the fact that this argument is presented in a public way, in a respectful way that we find to ourselves and to the other art, like the photographers who took these photos, is an example of how our role as artists somehow seems relegated in some ways to margins of the culture. And at the same time, we can also see how such a simple gesture can plant a seed actually of people's imaginations. And then that could actually contribute to a lot of explanation, a lot of discussions going further.
And on the topic of seeds, maybe we will talk about a current project we're working on right now. This is not quite worked out. So forgive us if it's not, if you find inconsistencies and you know, you can also help us think through it. But it's a project in St. Louis, Missouri, where we are doing billboards around this town called Saget, which was incorporated as Monsanto, and where Monsanto had their headquarters. They changed their name to Saget because they didn't want to be associated with Monsanto any longer. And then we are installing billboards or buying billboards from the Saget all the way to St. Louis, going through Monsanto Avenue, crossing through Monsanto Avenue, which if you go back to the map, you can see that where is Monsanto Avenue.
So you see the route 3. So this is just across the river from St. Louis. It's a town called Saget, as she said, and you can see Monsanto Avenue still is there. And so this is the headquarters of Monsanto Research, and it's actually the plume here. It's like the pollution that Monsanto generated. It's like it will be toxic for millions of years. This
area. It's completely desolated
right now. Right now it's desolate wasteland, and we're putting billboards along Route 3. And so the billboards are. We'll talk about that in a second. But we wanted to also mention that as part of this, we're making a podcast, and we're interviewing people. We're interviewing farmers, growers, scientists, activists, professors, and lawyers to get a clear picture about seeds. So we thought that seeds was this very important, overlooked, like it's essential to our life. So we're going to kind of present a skeleton notes of what we have so far.
And it's coming from the previous project that you just saw, the collaboration in Nature project. And the working title of the piece is Consuming Nature, Maybe Patenting Life, or Maybe Patenting Life, Consuming Nature. And it's public domain images of public domain seeds.
So there's a status of seed called public domain seeds. And these are different than patented seeds. And of course, we understand that Monsanto's business was to patent seeds. So we thought that using public domain images of public domain seeds was a very simple gesture, and putting those along the road next to the former Monsanto headquarters is a very important gesture.
And then I should add that the idea is that you listen to the podcast while you're driving the route and going through the billboards.
So these are mock-ups of the billboards. They will go up in October. But they are more or less going to be the images and more or less the locations. So here's the four locations right now, and the podcast will go something like this, and it'll be in combination. So we'll be talking a little bit, and also we're recording researchers and scientists and professors.
So a lot of these points will not be covered by us, but people who we ask the questions
to. Right. Do you like food? And we don't mean are you a foodie. We mean do you like food? We suspect that, like us, you also need food to survive. Since the 1980s, privatization and monopolization of our food supply has been underway under the empty promises of innovation. We've been talking with farmers, growers, scientists, activists, professors, lawyers to get a clear picture about what this means going forward and what it means when we look forward to dinner tonight. Life can be patented. Seeds can be patented. Restricting the use of seeds by farmers, restricting the genetic material that seeds have for researchers going forward. The key court cases that determined the patentability of life and of seeds, starting in 1980, Diamond versus Chakrabarty, the Supreme Court ruled that life was patentable.
They said anything under the sun that is made by man is patentable, whether it's alive or not. So you could patent life, basically.
In 1985, the U.S. Patent and Patent Board of Appeals and Interferences ruled that seeds, plant tissue cultures, and plants constituted patentable subject matter for utility patents. So utility patent is a patent granted by the U.S. Patent Office for novel and non-obvious invention or innovation that has a utility like a machine, a process, or a competition. Or a composition, sorry.
In 2001, EEM Agricultural Supply Inc. versus Pioneer Hybrid International Inc., a large seed company sued a very small seed supply company because they were supposedly selling patented seeds. And the Supreme Court ruled to back up the patent office ruling previously from 1985 and ruled that newly developed plant breeds are covered by expansive utility patents, giving large companies, seed companies, great power.
It's notable that on this Supreme Court decision from 2001, Justice Clarence Thomas wrote the majority opinion. Justice Clarence Thomas, for those of you who follow the Supreme Court at all, is an art conservative. Not only that, but he was literally from St. Louis and the former Monsanto patent lawyer.
Wow.
He was the patent lawyer for Monsanto in the 70s before he eventually became a Supreme Court justice. His majority opinion was, quote, "The relevant distinction was not between living and inanimate things, but between products of nature, whether living or not, and human-made inventions," end quote.
Which kind of points backs up the argument that anything under the sun, life or not, there is no distinction between being alive or not.
And finally, these precedents concluded, we can say, in 2013 with Bowman versus Monsanto, where the Supreme Court ruled again that farmers cannot save patented seeds.
So this was a farmer who was saving his seeds that he had bought from Monsanto to use them for the next year, and Monsanto sued him, and then the Supreme Court ruled that it does not permit a farmer to plant and grow saved patented seeds without the patent owner's permission.
So there's a number of things that we can get in and out of. So there are the legal arguments which are rooted in certain assumptions, but we also have the legal arguments that are pointing to philosophical assumptions, and this is where it becomes very interesting. And there's also these philosophical assumptions that are based in assumptions of capitalism. So the number one rationale that we understand with the fact that seeds can be patented is because patented seeds are meant to inspire innovation. And so the fact that a company can own a patent for 20 years, so the patent office currently has it for 20 years and they're non-renewable, then they go back to the public domain. What's happening is that companies can actually make a slight change again and then patent that again. So it is removing genetic information from from the public domain. But the key here is that innovation is supposed to be improved by awarding companies patents so that there's a financial motivation. This is a cynical argument because that disregards millions of years of innovations that humans have made on growing seeds based on selection. So like seed selection and hybrid seeds have been going on for a very, very long time without any patents. It's like people have been innovating for so long naturally that argument is already on unstable ground.
Seeds that are patented by a company cannot be saved or shared. Therefore, farmers are basically renting seeds instead of buying them. And this is an important argument that has been made to us time and time again, that farmers can only use the seeds for that season, therefore they're renting them for that season. As farmers have done for many thousands of years, they now cannot save their patented seeds for next season. The rise of seed patenting has caused a shift in the rights over seeds to the hands of multinational agrochemical corporations. While there is research refuting Bayer Monsanto's claims that GM crops yield more returns, thus justifying the higher prices and limited uses for seeds, farmers bought these seeds with the dubious promise of higher yields and increased profits.
So farmers have been buying them because they thought that there was a promise with these, that they could survive and they could be much more productive with GM, with patented seeds, with the way that seeds were marketed with Roundup and herbicides and fungicides and other things. So it turns out that the science is still, they're still researching it, but there has been a number of studies that show that GM seeds are actually not more productive, that are actually not yielding more returns than other seeds. So that's a problem number one. However, the promise of it was so great in the beginning, especially because smaller seed companies and smaller seeds and artisanal seed practices, open pollinated seeds, don't do well for scaling up in giant steps. So like huge fields of corn and soybeans and wheat, it's more, GM seeds are more predictable and they're more stable in that they literally are not meant to change at all from one generation to the other. So that promise meant that farmers bought onto it en masse. And what happened after that point was that this put out of business thousands and thousands of smaller seed companies, mostly local seed companies.
Well, maybe we can continue. Seed saving has been the way to farm for centuries. Seed saving allows growers to develop gene-diverse seeds that are more adaptable to the local environment's demands. Monocrops are proliferating. 75% of the world's food is produced from 12 plants, only 12 plants. Most heavily from corn, wheat, rice, and soybean. Patent protection, such as the genetically modified versions of these four plants that prohibits farmers from saving seeds, breeding them to make them more adaptive, is causing alarming gene uniformity, susceptible to climate change and random blights.
So here's the deal with genetically modified seeds and the mass consolidation of seeds. If a large percentage of a country, like let's say Bolivia, suddenly begins growing the same soybean seed for a cash crop, this means that the promise of certain farmers cashing in are very attractive. And farmers, they want those seeds. And it's attractive to think that they could cash in based on the promises that Monsanto gives. And so that's what happens. The problem with that is, GM seeds cannot control and predict all uncontrollable elements such as weather changes, droughts, and pests, bacteria that they didn't consider. So they can consider the known ones, and they might in the future begin to consider to genetically modify to control for a new environmental thing. But that process is very slow, and it leaves the farmer in the middle of a drought, like what happened in Bolivia. So there was a couple of seasons with some drought. These seeds are expensive. Monsanto gets their money no matter what happens to the farmer. So as these farmers were their crops were failing, Monsanto still got their money. The farmers were unable to keep their farm. And there is a huge instances of suicides in India for farmers who had there was a blight situation, there was a new virus that came in, there was a new insect that came in, and they were in debt for the seed companies. They couldn't make the debt, they commit suicide, like masses, lots of farmers. There's a huge instance also in other countries where not only do the farmers lose the farm, but some of the these companies that sell the GM seeds are then buying up the farms at fire sale prices.
So control over seeds in many ways is control of our food supply. The power over seeds has shifted from small seed growers and small seed companies to monopolies. In 1996, there were 600 independent seed companies operating in the US. By 2009, this number shrunk to 100. And by 2016, the 10 biggest seed sellers control 75% of the global market. By 2019, there are four big seed companies, four, which is Monsanto, that was bought by Bayer, Corteva, which is a new firm that is the consolidation of Dow and DuPont and Chem China and BASF. Those are the four big.
So now there's four.
Which control 60% of the global proprietary seed sales and continue to consolidate smaller regional seed companies and increase their ownership of genetic material itself.
So as each of these mergers happen, these companies get larger and larger and they control more and more seed patents. And so more and more seed patents and more and more. So a seed patent is basically a patent on genetic material. And a utility patent actually describes certain characteristics that plant has. And we've been trying to understand how the patent trademark office awards these. And it seems to us that.
Well, what the patent lawyer told us is that the patent office has to prove that it's not novel, not original, and also that someone with knowledge in the field will not have come up with it anyway. That is not some illogical thing to come up with if you work in the field. So it's the job of the patent office to prove that it's not novel and that it's somehow special. So it's... I mean, in this patent lawyer's mind, it's not so much the job, the fault of the patent office, but how it's set up. That is kind of like you get the patent unless the patent office can prove that it's unpatentable. And since what is unpatented, which is patentable, has been expanding and expanding.
So the problem is that it seems to us that while it might be a complicated situation, that there are instances in which these four large seed companies are actually threatening lawsuits for smaller seed companies like this one, Adaptive Seeds, based in Oregon. So they do open pollinated,
open source, and
heirloom seeds. And these seeds, they are carefully maintaining. It's kind of like a seed library. And so they have a certain number of seeds that they keep alive by planting the crop. So they have, you have to plant the crop and then get the seeds the next year in order to be able to distribute those seeds. And so that's what they're doing at this adaptive seed. But they've actually been threatened by BASIF, who sent a threatening letter saying that they actually own the genetic material for some of their seeds. And they're very unspecific about which ones they were. And we're going to like research what this letter says later. She said she's going to send it to us. But she said that that BASIF is claiming that they own the certain colors of vegetables.
Oh, my God.
So what we have here is a situation in which it's clear that the law is enabling this kind of chaos of like interpretation. The law is enabling what we can only describe as like a massive overreach of like ownership of like of companies asserting ownership over what is clearly a public domain or like world heritage. Mm-hmm.
So then here comes where the project comes in, that non-patented seeds, on the other hand, they can be shared, they can be saved, they can be, growers can use them, they can be traded. Non-patented seeds strengthen the commons and allow small farmers to slowly adapt to changes by using a much greater range of types of seeds and plants further, rather than follow the promises of large returns on a cash monocrop. A strong and diverse genetic plant range means ethical farming, healthier food, and also nimble production that can adapt to environmental changes. So we have been talking to farmers, growers, scientists, activists, lawyers, teachers that proposed alternative structures such as open source seeds, which are seeds that when you buy, you sign a contract saying that you are going to let anyone use it, you're never going to patent, you can do whatever you want to with it, but as long as it stays open source.
In the public domain.
Seed banks, which are seeds that you can borrow and then you can save as well, and seed saving networks. Different structures to maintain seeds in the public domain. And hence where the photos come from, public domain photos of public domain seeds.
So the US agricultural, USDA, the US
Department of Agriculture.
US Department of Agriculture has an agriculture research center. And they take these wonderful photos, and they're all in the public domain because they're public employees. We are actually in the process of contacting the photographers and thinking about which photos to use in the billboards. We are also taking photos ourselves of open source seeds. So some of the photos that you saw are ours, but it's not so important to like point them out. But
and also finding people who work with them, and I want to keep them in the public domain and researchers. So a variety of sources for the photographs.
And we are compiling photographs in the public domain in order to highlight the utility of keeping a public domain in terms of culture, but making this parallel with seeds.
And this is what we're working on right now. So maybe we could open it up now. That was a lot.
How do you hope that your billboards can make change, or what is the hopeful outcome of, I mean, the project is profound, I mean, obviously, and what do you hope the impact will be to possibly make change or educate people?
Well, we can't like pretend to be so naive that we could just fix it.
We were talking to a patent lawyer, and she said the moment that the 2001 Supreme ruling happened, it was a done deal. And she said, I agree with you philosophically. I think life should not be patentable. I think it's a bad ruling, but I think you're basically, but then later she was like, you know what? If enough people know about it, if enough people care about it, then this kind of be, you know, these structures can be changed. So then she, at the end, she was like, well, maybe it is worthwhile.
Right.
So that's one thing, but we can say that we're operating on a couple of different levels. So like as human beings, like maybe it's kind of obvious that we are like super idealistic, like naively, we could say like we are just profoundly childishly like idealistic. So that's like the fundamental premise about how we work. We also understand that this is not exactly a functional strategy, but we still feel like it's important that somebody is. So that's partially. So the other thing is the actual billboards. We like the idea that first of all, it's a punk rock gesture. We have huge, beautiful images in the landscape of an industrial wasteland of the actual location where partially this like in, kind of like industrialized wastelands are allowed to happen. Like they actively are like contributing to this kind of destruction. So that gesture of placing a beautiful image of health in the middle of an image of like decay and despair is a punk rock gesture. And we just that alone is enough for us to want to do this project. The second thing is it's a very subtle and kind of obvious. So we're working with Max, who you'll meet in a few weeks. So Max Jorge Hinderer Cruz, we've been talking about this project together for a long time, and he's also been really shocked and surprised. But he understands the situation in Bolivia, and he works with artists who deal with Monsanto in Bolivia and artists who deal with Monsanto in Argentina. And we're gonna also speak with those artists. And so he understands the prospect, like this situation from a certain perspective, but he's also very surprised by some of these Supreme Court rulings. It's amazing that they're not completely known and by the public. So what he said was he was attracted to the project because of how simple the title was. I mean, it's public domain images of public domain seeds. So that is like such a simple thing. And it's such a like, and he was saying that, I mean, when we came up with it, it was just so stupidly simple. Like sometimes when something is so easy, you can't believe that somebody else hasn't already like figured it out. But like to make this parallel between the privatization of images and the privatization of food, it's a simple gesture of a connection. It's a connection that hasn't, you know, it's like we need to think about this because, and here's why, it's the exact same source. It's the assumption that privatization is the best way of living. And that assumption generates the private control of images, the private control of seeds, the private control of post office, that was what they were hoping to do last year in like the private control of all these things that are
education,
healthcare. Yeah. It just goes on and on and on from there. So the assumption that privatization, that a for-profit company is the best way to manage everything. That's what the shared thing is. So what we hope to change, you know, if people would talk about it, if it got written about in some newspapers and maybe some people actually reconsidered it, ideally what we would like is a philosophical recognition that these patents that the Supreme Court upheld are philosophically invalid. That's what we would like. Philosophically, they are outrageous. And that is like what we would really hope could happen. Like whether or not it's going to happen, I don't know, but we can put it out there and like figure out from there. But
that's why we're doing the podcast, because we also feel like if enough informed people that were interviewed make the argument, and a recording is easier to digest in relationship to the images. And also we're getting press involved to hopefully, you know, like even just the mention, a couple of mentions in newspapers, I think can do a lot. So I don't know, you do these things and you hope. We can't be so naive to think that all of a sudden people are going to be, but you know, if only the change is that a few more people are aware of it, then at least it's something.
Yeah, sure.
Katia?
Hi, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm really interested in how you two work together and how you choose the projects that you do and how you share roles and power in collaborate in your collaborations. It's really interesting.
What has shifted? Because, well, one thing to acknowledge is that we met when we were late teenagers, basically. So we never had our own practice. We always, all the work that, we have never had our own practice. We never do our own work. So in a way, the work that we do is just what we do. And we don't know anything else, so to speak. But then it has changed because we were doing sound more, and then which is more collaborative anyway. It's more normal for musicians to collaborate, and we have always been working with other people, you know, like with either like we did with Piscine, where I was working with a collective, or even, you know, with Max and with the people that were interviewing. We meet with Max weekly almost to talk about what we have found out, and then we the people that were interviewing, we send the writing to them. So I see an artistic practice as a collaborative practice anyway. But then for us, I think it just changes with time and with the projects. And I think it's mostly based on meetings and deciding things. And then we kind of go on our own and research different things or do different things. And then we have another meeting where we share. So it's not like we're working like hand on hand, but we kind of gather thoughts, decide, and then go on our own.
So to make a kind of direct image, so we have this studio that we're sitting in now, and there are two architects' tables facing each other. So this is my desk, and over there is her desk. And so like we face each other with these architect tables, at least that was the idea. The reality is, she just sits here too. We don't use the other side of the table at all, ever. I don't think anybody sat there in 8 months. And so what we do instead is that part of the desk became like the workstation. So that's where we assemble things, and that's where we cut things. And so like that's just how it is. We have very little separation in like life and art making. And so it's hard to say we have a strategy. It's just that we don't have any other strategy.
Sounds very symbiotic. Sounds like just water.
Yeah, I mean, it's like water in which there is still fights.
Yeah,
but no, that.
But it's magical too. It's magical.
Yeah, there aren't that many fights. I would say, like during the pandemic, we had two fights, which is pretty good. I think
that's pretty good
for a year and a half.
I told a friend, and she was like, "Really?" And I was like, "And for us, she was like, oh my god, we had to fight. This is the end of the world." I don't know. I mean, I don't say it's for everyone, and I don't even think that we planned it that way, but this is just how it happened for us. And we just exchange roles a lot. Like I help him with his teaching, and he helps me with my teaching, and we share, you know, housework and taking care of Agnes, and it just doesn't seem to be such a huge divide that way.
It sounds very egalitarian, but sounds great. Yeah. Thank you.
Ahuva?
Yeah, maybe it's a continuation of Katsia's question, but I'm interested in the process of how do you take a general interest that you have, and I'm talking about the long-term kind of like project-based artist, because that's what you do. You move from one project to another. How does one take an interest that they have and create this passion to make work about it? So I'm interested in environmental topics and politics and a lot of things that I can dig in really deeply, but I don't necessarily develop a passion to make work about it. And I wonder, and maybe it's also an impossible question to answer, But this is something I struggle with. Right now I have a topic, I work, I read about it, I develop it. But then once I kind of like extract everything from this idea, I wonder how I can move on to a next idea.
Well, I guess one thing I will say is that you don't have to necessarily do work about things that you are thinking about or care about in other aspects of your life. I think that that's a choice that could be made, but doesn't need to be made. But you could participate politically by other means, or you know, conceptually through other means. But I think that for us, what helped us a lot was writing, because I feel like a lot of the time, as we're writing texts, then the artworks bounce off these things that we're writing. And then it's very easy for one thought to go into the other, because that's how, you know, books are written or how arguments are written. So to us, I feel like we were doing more different works until we started writing more. And then like you just get immersed into these thinking processes, and then you can't avoid but making work about them.
Mm. So we sent writings for today's, I don't think we have time to talk about them, but we can in the future. But yeah, I think writing is really important to sort of, for us to come to terms with the subject in a really deeper way, in a kind of rounded way. And then to make artworks about them, I mean, the artworks have to function in different levels, like conceptually, intellectually, but also we have to figure out a way of making them art. As compared to making them a writing. So a lot of things are eliminated, and we consider a lot of things. I guess we feel like as amateurs, we can really go into other fields very deeply. And so now, like when we're talking to seed growers, we're finding that we're actually like riffing back and forth, because we've been studying seeds for long enough to where we know some things that some other people who are experts now in seeds, they didn't know.
And then on the other hand, you're afforded so many more licenses, because we could just be like, oh, we're artists and we don't know so much about this, but will you talk to us? And then like people were like taking us under their wing, that if we would have been like even just university professors, they will not have. I think that the level of artists is very helpful in research, because people will often welcome you kinder if you come as an artist.
Yeah, so we get a lot of license because we say we're stupid, we're artists, we have no idea what we're doing, like please help us. And then like people do. Like the one professor, Jeff Klickenberg, he's retired, but he talked to us for like 2.5 hours.
It was an incredible
on
lecture.
On the phone one day. And like, we're getting like full on like master's degree level education in seeds now, because we're just reaching out to people and as like an inspired amateur, with the promise that we might actually make like larger visibility. And so people are actually interested to talk to us because they feel like nobody's listening to them.
That, I mean, that's the exchange, right? That we feel like we have no knowledge. It's very difficult to Google this stuff. Will you help us? And then they feel like here comes these people from the outside. We know, everyone knows each other within the community. We talk to one another. Let's see if bringing someone from the outside will move the conversation somewhere else. So then these relationships can become really helpful and really interesting. That's making them an argument for research-based practice that is beyond academics, but is actually talking to real people. I mean, real people, academics are also real people, but anyway, talking to people who are not academics.
Yes, thank you. I'm just fascinated, I think, about the intellectual part of approaching art. And I think probably working as a duo helps, because you can just talk and fight all the time about it and then
come up with
something.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, it has to be a bit of both, you know. We also love to sit down and paint.
Yeah, which is where the Goya series was really therapeutic, because we could, you know, there was some content to it. So, but overall, it was very meditative practice, which is also important.
And we didn't show these, but we just moved on to these boxes on the floor. So now we're painting Amazon boxes with ink.
Because we're feeling so guilty about getting deliveries to our house when we make them into artwork. I don't know if it's any better, but anyway.
Any other thoughts or questions?
I was curious about the Goya series and all the things you said about ink, if that was something you knew beforehand, or if that's something that like came out as you were going and it like further informed what you were doing.
Yeah, we started because we just love black ink. We love Sumi ink, and we just love how it feels and love how it paints. And it also works because it's very opaque, so it functions really well for what we're doing. And then we decided we're thinking about it in bigger terms, and we're thinking like, what is this stuff exactly? And then we started to get curious, and we just started to go on ResearchGate and email materials scientists to ask them to send us their papers. And we got a number of material scientists from Korea and from Japan that would just email it, and they would say, oh, sorry, so many of our papers are not translated, but here's one that's like partially translated. There's like two paragraphs in English, and we got to try and figure out how to deal with that. And so we were just like curious and wanted to know more, and we were going out and finding this information.
But that was kind of a beautiful project for us, because we had that once, as I was saying, this meditative activity that was very fulfilling. And then on the other hand, we had the research aspect where we could read scientific papers and we could really start seeing connections. So then our mind was also getting pleasure at the same time as we were getting the physical pleasure of making the paintings.
Right. Do you feel like there was a change in your approach to the painting from like start to finish, or did that feel kind of consistent?
Yeah.
Well, we had to buy 5 of those books.
Oh, wow.
So we were like, we threw away almost all of them from the beginning.
Yeah.
So we were just going over and over and over. So we painted hundreds of them. And we figured like, we were getting a couple of them right. And we're like, something about this is right. And then we kept going, and then it was hard because we were trying to figure out how to paint with the etchings. And so like to generate brush strokes that seemed like they could blend in with the printmaking technique. And so we had an idea of how it could work. And we just kept going at it and going at it and going. And then we were buying also, because it was like too expensive for us to buy the expensive one. So we bought some of the cheaper reproductions of the Goya books
to practice.
And so we were just sitting here practicing and like throwing them away. And finally we got 83 paintings that we thought were really good after going through like maybe 10 books in total.
But as we were doing the research and thinking about what we were doing, at the beginning it was more of a intuitive process, but as we were thinking more and researching more, they became more intentional. This idea of the landscape, this idea of sci-fi, this idea of environmental dread. So then, yes, he was saying we basically didn't use any of the first ones, but it was still good to see how the brush will behave with the ink. And another thing that it was interesting is that because the originals, let's say, were prints in metal plates, they had all these textures to them, and in the sky and in the floor. And then we got all these brushes with different techniques to imitate or to resonate or to play with these textures of the metal plates. So that also became kind of a process to figure out how to use the brushes and how to use the materials we had. So the first ones kind of served as experiments, formally and conceptually.
Cool, thank you.
Any other thoughts or questions?
What is the When is the exhibition at the Luminary? And I know you have the billboards planned, but do you have any ideas of how this idea will live in a physical space?
Yeah, there's not going to be an exhibition. It's just the billboards and the podcast. Okay. And we're also writing texts that we're going to publish along with Max. So we're writing a collaborative text together that will be published in March in the journal that's associated with the Luminary. And we've also been invited to write a text for an issue of OEI from Stockholm. So there's at least two texts that we'll publish in collaboration with Max in the project. So the project will live as like first billboards for a month, and then the podcast on the website, and then documentation of the billboard and the podcast on the website, and then texts on other websites. So it's kind of like moving from there. And what we thought about is that we would like to approach other cities that are associated with agribusiness and do more billboards. So I think that'll be the next one.
Very exciting. When are the billboards going to be up? I'm going to be there in October.
October.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm going to go find them.
See the billboards and hear the podcast by then.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, we will only go if Agnes was vaccinated, but that's a very big if. I don't think she will manage.
We'll see.
Yeah.
Vin, did you have a question?
I do. I should have two. One, I was wondering how much you two were influenced, if at all, by stuff like the Adbusters. Because a lot of your work really seems like there's some crossover in terms of their, like, not quite Marxist, but sort of like anti-consumerist and anti-capital kind of things that they do. I know they're based in Canada, but they sometimes operate down here in the States too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, I have seen their projects and they're kind of inspiring in a way. So for sure. I mean, I think when you deal with political realities in an explicit way, you know, we have a certain number of other practitioners that are doing that. And Adbusters is certainly one of them. I guess the main thing that would be between us and Adbusters is that we really love to make art, and we really insist to produce objects and to produce like images that we think are exciting and interesting for us personally, and also can transmit these ideas. So while we think that what Adbusters is doing, the difference is that we like art more than they do. I wouldn't say that any of them are super interested in art in itself.
And I guess I should say that we have spent most of our visual art life making objects, like objects for a gallery that had some kind of political intention. But I think that maybe like this billboard project is as close as, I guess, what you will call political art or activism through art. But a lot of our practice is like kind of like metaphorical aesthetic objects that have a political social message embedded into it.
Yeah.
Oh, right. All right. The other question I had was, have you considered doing any digital campaigns? It seems like a lot of times, especially these days, Clear Channel has their billboards, and then there's some complimentary digital campaign that they're running, or like on radio ads, just to get full spectrum. If you guys are considering doing any digital campaigns for your stuff as well, because that would give you a little more surface area to I'm not sure if it's really getting the message out, because people know, we all know, there's a certain amount of cynical distance that most of us are engaged in with these topics. But more or less just a way to get more contact space for them with this topic that we don't want to really confront if we can help it.
I mean, that's a challenge, because we really would like to, this is the challenge of the podcast and of presenting the work to you right now, and the presenting the work in the abstract, is that we would like to give deeper information, because we're gaining a lot of information, and we would like to somehow transmit this like richer perspective of the situation. that a advertising campaign, the very nature of it cannot give that kind of depth of information. And so for us, the challenge is how can we get people involved and how can we make people aware of it without resulting to what we would consider like a lack of depth that an advertising campaign has. Mm-hmm. So that's a challenge and we're trying to figure it out. So like the billboards, I mean, that's kind of like calling attention in a way to the shallowness of an advertising campaign, but because it has the richness behind these images are symbolic. And the symbolic, you know, the symbolic moment of having this particular image on this particular site is rich enough to where even if it's like using the sort of the typical advertising language, like these could be advertisements. All we would need to do was write Monsanto on the top of the literally write the logo Monsanto on the top, and it would be an advertisement for Monsanto. So I think that like having the quality of image be advertisement quality, but having the actual message behind it be a much richer and more subtle, more like maybe like punk rock gesture, that kind of combination is important to us. But we're still working it out and we would be willing to like change media. But if we would change media, we would have to be very careful to figure out how to do it in our way.
Right. But I think this project, the problem is that we have always been rather happy to not have a huge audience, let's say. Like, you know, we grew up with this idea of like being the alternative. Yeah, you didn't want to be in the mom or whatever, because then you were the guy. So we have always been quite happy to, you know, when people say, oh, you're obscure, or what's that word that people use?
Obscure or
esoteric.
Esoteric or insular. So these are terms that we've often heard about our practice. Purposely do not try to make popular looking or feeling anything.
Or even like promote ourselves or whatever. So this up to this point, up to this project has been fine and great. But then now we feel like we have a responsibility to the people who have entrusted us with this knowledge and this information. So then I think we are maybe the first time in our lives where we will consider that properly. We will consider something that was more effective in transmitting a message.
Yeah. Cool. Yeah, I see that as kind of the challenge with having a digital campaign too, because right now, the work you're doing, a lot of it is very site-specific. And I mean, it's not impossible to make a site-specific piece that lives online, but that's a whole other set of considerations about what is site-specific and what the site is itself.
Yeah. Cool.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks for your question.
Travis?
Yes. So I think a bit of an add-on to Vin, and then what you opened with the balance between naivety or idealistic, but wanting this further philosophical recognition, I may use the word reclamation, awareness, and thinking what Vin was saying was, The latter part of my undergrad study was about this story and environment and really what you guys are talking about and how to communicate this in-depth, like all the research you guys have done, this is long form. And I think it'll work really well on a podcast. And then is, you know, a lot of people know, but there's a lot of like phrases that we say in conversation about the environment, about seeds, about how we get food, how we're living with the earth. And they get reduced down to very limited, sometimes completely incorrect statements. And how do we communicate maybe in short form and long form, what this message, or maybe have a tale that they're able to see a podcast that's more long form, but the billboards are real short, but they're powerful and they can lead to something, you know, maybe an action, maybe a passive action is what I want to use, a passive action that leads people to a forum of discussion.
Yeah.
As we grow, like the consciousness and the awareness of like real details of what we're doing to our earth and how we're living in conjunction with all living things.
Yeah.
I don't know if that even makes any sense, but those are just like this way of communicating, long form versus our culture of 140 characters.
Yeah.
Or less.
That's a problematic thing. And this is partially why we stay away from social media, because we just don't do well with short form. But we are trying to figure out a way of dealing with short form that is a poetic, like artistic expression that has this immediacy that actually does work, but still doesn't function as an advertisement. So it's a very difficult balance, and it's like challenging for us to figure that out.
But you're totally right in that both are needed. Because one thing is you can't ask people to listen through half an hour podcast, or you can't expect people to read the book. Some people will, but there is a benefit to this kind of short form immediacy that I think should not be underestimated. Then the question is how it's done and, doing it properly. Yeah.
I've been really just looking at this because I'm like equally annoyed by memes, and then there's some that are so powerful, but it's these deeper conversations that are really vital to get all of the nuances around these topics that we are engaged in, every single one of us are engaged in. And the project that you guys, when we're talking about food, like our life fuel, it's a level of urgency that it's big. So I'm just thinking about that short form, long form, and how that's communicated and what tools do we use without being so commercial, maybe, or just are missing that artistic touch.
Yeah.
Will. I don't know. Those are just some things that come up.
These are the things that we're talking about right now.
Exactly what we're mulling over right now.
Debating and figuring out. So,
yeah. Thanks for bringing it up.
I think we have to go get diagnosis in outdoor summer camp.
Yep. And so we have to call
it. If we are the last one, she gets very upset.
Call it a day. So thanks for everyone for sticking with us and for the conversation. And we can continue this conversation in different forms in the future. So looking forward to that. And anyway, I hope everyone feels good. For those who are not feeling well, I hope that you recover very, very soon. I'm very sorry for this situation. And I have a good feeling that it's all going to pass really quick and it's going to be fine.
And one thing to say is that, this group has been so great, and you really feel a sense of care for one another. And, like everyone says, so we're in this together, but it really feels in this case that we are in this together. So.
Yeah, thanks for communicating and being clear, because we're all trying to figure out what the best thing is to do. And yeah, so thanks for communicating and working together on this.
Thank you for bringing your work. I know
you're
hesitant, but I love that.
Yeah, thank you so much. I really enjoyed that.
And yeah, thank you.
Powerful, that's a big deal.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, everyone.
Bye.
See you real soon.
Bye.
is there not another lecture?